Welcome to Founder Dialogues, number 16 that we've done in the series. We've been doing this for about 6 years. I'm Eric Paley. I'm with a venture capital fund, a seed stage venture capital fund here in Boston called Founder Collective. We started doing this event series because when I was a student here in Boston, I couldn't have named for you three CEOs in the Boston tech community. Right? There are plenty of incredible success stories, and yet somehow the stories are not told enough. People don't know them. Boston doesn't celebrate success well. We put our heads down and we build stuff. And nobody talks about all the great things that are happening. And so we've been very lucky over the years to have some amazing entrepreneurs who have built companies, billions in assets, incredible Boston tech stories. And we've got a great one today that we're going to go into in detail. Just quickly, I want to thank my team. First, my partner David is here. Joe and Toma, who actually run the event for us. And then I've got a couple more important, also sponsors I've got to acknowledge. KPMG helps fund this event, so thank you to the KPMG team. Really appreciate that. Patty Chen feeds us from Patty Chen's dumplings. So go over to her place in Central Square, because it's awesome. And then we've started doing this. At some point, somebody suggested, you know, if you're going to have all these great guests and an incredible audience, you should try to use that as an opportunity to raise a little bit of money for a nonprofit related to the startup community. So we've been supporting Build with this event and with, thank you, your donations. And I just want to give a moment for Pepper to come and tell us about Build so everyone can just hear a little bit about Build and if you're interested, how you can get involved. So we'll do that really quickly.
Hi, thanks for the intro. Build is a really great program. We work with students in Boston high schools who are at risk of dropping out, and we provide them with a really unique learning opportunity with entrepreneurship. So we pair our students with mentors from the entrepreneur community, and they start real businesses and earn real profits. And in the process, they learn math, writing, sales, marketing, and soft skills like communication, teamwork. So it's a really great program. If you're interested, it's super simple to get involved. Just text Build Boston to 97000, and you'll get a little link to sign up for our mailing list, or you can just come right back here and give us your card or write down your name for us. Thanks.
And I just want to emphasize one part of that. Pepper mentioned they build real businesses with real profits, which is unlike the tech community mostly. So I think that's impressive. So okay, now to turn our attention to David Cancel, our guest of the day. This is many years in the making for me. I've been wanting to get David here for a long time. It's also the first time we've ever featured an entrepreneur who is running a company in Founder Collective's portfolio. So if there's a little bias of how much I love David, you'll know why. But just a tiny bit of background on David, and then we'll dive in. He's a New Yorker like myself. He's a Queens guy. He's a Mets fan, which is very important, like me. He learned entrepreneurship firsthand from his parents, a handyman and a dressmaker. We'll talk a little about that. He's a full-stack engineer, which goes as deep as laying all the Cat 5 cables throughout his office in his early startups. He's co-founded 5 startups, so he's as serial an entrepreneur as I can think of in the Boston community. He's had exits of over 100 million. Actually, if you include HubSpot, which I think is fair, you've had exits of over a billion. Give that some credit too. And I think more to come as a drift investor. He's built social networks, B2B analytics, SaaS tools. And if you have a chance, you should check out his blog. He's got great advice for founders, much of which I agree with, some of which we all knew about. Yeah. And if you can't get him to advise you as a founder, check out DCancel, him on Twitter. He's got some great commentary on there that's very helpful. Today, you're the CEO of Drift, which is a relatively early stage company, raised over $15 million from us, but primarily from Charles River Ventures, now called CRV, and General Catalyst. But we're very proud to be on the cap table. And just last week, you launched Drift 2.0. which is an AI bot interface for a lot of the customer success and customer acquisition capabilities that Drift has been built around. Correct. So I think we should take 1 minute. I'm just going to run a quick video that introduces you to Drift 2.0.
Hey, I'm Matt from Drift. Drift is a messaging app that lets your business talk to visitors and customers from anywhere in real time. This all starts with your website. Your website is the hub of your business. Visitors come and go, and if you're like me and you're a visitor to any given website, you don't want to talk to a rep, you don't want to fill out a form, you just want your questions answered when you need it. So that's where Drift comes in. It lets you as a business interact with your visitors and customers to convert them into leads. And Drift doesn't stop there. You can also use Drift in your product so that you can get users' feedback, measure your customer satisfaction, engage them, and ultimately, what that leads to is a happier, more engaged customer. The best part about Drift is that it works with all of the tools that you're already using today. So whether that's HubSpot or Segment or Zapier, Drift integrates seamlessly with all of those so you don't have to change your workflows. Speaking of seamless integrations, we also have a two-way Slack integration that lets you and your business talk to your customers and visitors at any time from anywhere in the app that you use the most. Give it a shot and let us know what you think. Get started for free today. So give it a shot and let us know what you think. Get free for started.
With that, Dave Cancel. So hello. Dave. Hello, thanks for doing this.
Does anyone notice we're wearing the same shirt?
Yeah.
It's a little faux pas. Yeah.
My wife told me I wasn't dressed up enough, made me change my shirt to David's shirt. So so AI bots are kind of all the rage. I'm getting pitched a lot of them right now.
Oh, yeah.
Right? So, and you know, there's a bot as part of Drift 2.0. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to start with just high level. Where are we in sort of the bot hype cycle? And is this whole bot thing real? Like, is this just, you know, is this how we're all going to be interacting with everything? Or is it just the it will work in some use case and not others, the theme of the moment? Where are we on that hype cycle?
Yeah, I don't know. At Drift, we think, who knows, is the meta answer. But like, you know, at Drift, we think that we're finally at a point that we can use bots in a way to help make conversations a little bit more personal. Those things sound like they're in conflict, but they're not in our case. I don't know, if you're as old as me, then you've seen bots and AI has been coming for every 5 years since I've been in this industry, and so it's been going on, ongoing for a long time. I think what's changed is that we first needed the cloud, right? So we needed cloud. Then we needed access to data, so kind of settling down of the API layers. So and that's happened over time, and now we're getting to a point that we have enough data scale, enough access to data that we're at the beginning of making some of this stuff possible. I'd say most bots that I use today are toys and interesting from a development standpoint and kind of geeky, but I don't really see a use for them. And at Drift, we're using a bot not to replace a human, but to get a conversation to a human, to route it to a human as quickly as possible. So we think of the bot as kind of a concierge for your business. So how do I like greet someone and then route them to a real human as quickly as possible?
So I was chatting with Mark from Patty Chen's Dumplings. Mm-hmm. Mark, I don't know if you're still back there, but if you are, you can wave. But and he was saying, there's Patty, and he was saying, well, couldn't I use this to take in all my catering orders? Mm. And it would have enough data to be programmed to know, to ask the right questions. Okay, well, how many people are you having? So we need this many of this type of dumpling.
Sure.
You know, does anyone not eat pork? Okay, we'll redo this.
Yeah.
What do you think?
I think yes, someday. I don't think we're there yet, right? And I think nothing is worse than having that kind of frustrating experience. And so I've been using every kind of bot possible for a long time. And I think a lot of them, especially in the e-commerce and order taking scenario, kind of annoying because I don't know, in some cases you need to browse, right? So you need to know what's available.
Right.
And so these kind of general purpose e-commerce bots where you have to remember that you want, oh, I want a blue pen. I want a blue pen from this manufacturer. Okay, I should talk to this bot. And it's kind of more work than going through a form-based process in that scenario.
So let's nail down, where does it work well, and pull that back to Drift. Why does it work well for what Drift's trying to do?
Yeah, I think if you come to a website or you come to an app, like one of our customers, and you're trying to get an answer, you're trying to get to a human, and so you have a sales question, a support question, a product question, whatever the question is, we can use the bot to ask a very simple question, who are you trying to get to? Oh, I have a product question, okay. That's when the bot goes off and tries to connect you to a real human within that company. I have a sales question, same thing.
How different is that than calling and, you know, press one for sales, press two for service, mm-hmm. press three for...
It's a little different. So obviously it's conversational. If we know who you are And in the case of our customers, then we can route you directly. We don't have to ask you that. So then there's intelligence about who the customer is, who the prospect is, who the lead is, and then past behavior that you may have in the app or on the website that we can take into account to route you correctly.
So the answer is just there's a lot more intelligence about the customer applied to that moment than just sort of one for this, two for
exactly.
This.
What we're trying to replicate with this is kind of if you think of the best retail experience that you have in the real world, right? And you think of maybe a place that you frequent a lot and they know you, here comes Eric. Right. And the way that they treat you and know your preferences and kind of get you to the right person or to the right product, that's what we're trying to replicate with the DriftBot, right? So we're not trying to replace any humans in that equation. What we're trying to do is learn about you and kind of route you to the right place.
I prefer feather pillows.
Feather pillows.
Should be in a database somewhere. Okay, so let's go back to Queens.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's talk about your parents. What did you learn about entrepreneurship? I mean, you shared this idea with me that you learned a lot about entrepreneurship from two parents who really were in the trades.
Yep.
How? What did they teach you that's applicable to your work since?
I think I'm still discovering that, right? It's something that unfolds over time. Both my parents emigrated here to the U.S. And then, like most immigrants to the U.S., kind of worked on their own. My mom, a dressmaker, my dad, in the trades, kind of handyman, builder type job. And I learned a couple things. One, work ethic, right? So one thing that I shared with you that I think about a lot is that no matter how hard we've worked in this startup world, technology world, I always look back at my parents and I think, oh, I haven't worked 1 week yet as hard as my parents did. And that's not exaggerating, that's pretty accurate.
Is that hours or calluses?
Hours, calluses, and reward, right? And so what kind of reward were you getting for that type of work? Why were you doing that work, right? Were you getting recognition? Were you getting financial reward? All those things, right. Were not there, right? So, and yet they were working and trying to support myself and my brother and our family, right? And so I saw that work ethic. I don't think that's unique. I think a lot of immigrants go through that, and right, that's part of why there are so many immigrants and children of immigrants who are entrepreneurs, right?
But a lot of kids of skilled trade workers learn those skills, right? I mean, it's something you can pass from parent to child. Mm-hmm. How come you're not in either of those trades?
Trade? Maybe I should be. Yeah.
But what something changed in the sort of typical trajectory?
Yeah, my dad never wanted me to do what he was doing. Why? Probably because he wanted me to have a better life or an easier life. He never said that, but that's what I assume. And so even though I wanted to do and tag along with what he was doing, he wouldn't let me. And so he wouldn't let me do that, and so I had to find my own way.
What did he want you to do?
Anything but that, right? And so, I shared with you that my mom was the only one that ever said what she wanted me to do. She wanted me to be an accountant. And why did she want me to be an accountant? No idea. I'm pretty sure my mom didn't really know what an accountant was, right? But she knew that they wore suits and they had a briefcase and they went to work and they had kind of a steady kind of job. And it's like businessman, lawyer, doctor, that's pretty much it, right? That's what they want. And my mom passed away years ago now. And even though by that point I had sold multiple companies, I'm pretty sure she was still disappointed that I wasn't an accountant and that I didn't get a good job, right?
Yeah. At some well-known place KPMG.
Yeah. Exactly, yes. Take the subway wearing a suit every day.
That was my best product placement opportunity right there. So what did you want to be? What was your notion of when I grow up, I'm going to be X?
I wanted to own a business, right? I wanted to be a business owner. I didn't know what that meant. And maybe it was because seeing my parents go through what they were going through. And so I wanted to own a business. And so I used to read these magazines, Entrepreneur Magazine and a couple other magazines that were around back then. Those magazines were mostly about franchising businesses. So franchising a dry cleaner.
Which you actually need a bunch of money to do.
You need like $500,000 to franchise a dry cleaner or open a Wendy's or something like that. And then at the back, there'd be a lot of multi-level marketing kind of things. But anyway, this is the only world, this is the only thing I could see that was a business, right? I think like so many things now when I look at my kids now and I look at all of us and all the access that we have to information and so much about the world. I mean, I grew up, probably you grew up in this innocent time, right? Pre internet, right? And so like, unless you read it in a book or a magazine or you knew someone directly, like you didn't even know that things were possible. So all I knew was like, in this magazine, these people own businesses. I want to own a business one day. I don't know how to get there. I don't know what that means. I don't know how I'm going to get $500,000 to open a Wendy's, but you know, I just knew I wanted to own a business.
Yeah, because you think about it, the way we discovered things were magazines and, and television.
That's it.
And neither one was really proactive. If you actually wanted to go down some thread and learn something, maybe go to library.
I spent a lot of time in the library.
Pretty hard to do.
It's funny because I, for a long time, not until recently was I even comfortable with the word entrepreneur.
Yeah.
Because back then when I was growing up, entrepreneur meant like infomercial person, right? Or a person who like multi-level marketers is kind of like a dark, it wasn't, you know, the celebrated.
My grandfather told me an entrepreneur is a bum.
Pretty much, yeah.
So, but it was. Kind of, there was a lot of negative stigma.
Yeah.
Was it foregone conclusion you'd go to college? You, neither of your parents went. Were you in a community where everyone went to college?
Yeah, pretty much everyone went to college.
So how'd you end up at Queens College? Besides you're a Mets fan and it's kind of what you do.
You know, default, you know, I think is probably the easiest. You know, again, I didn't know what was possible. So I lived in Queens. There was a school called Queens College. There were a bunch of city schools. And actually, I didn't care about school at all, right? And so I'd say one of the, now I can look back at these things and think like, oh, you know, all my teachers would always say the same thing. High potential, you know, lazy. High potential, you know, high, smart, but you know, it doesn't apply themselves, whatever. And then now I can look at kids and understand exactly what was going on and with my personality, which is if I'm interested in something, then I go 1,000% in it and become an expert in that thing. And if I'm not interested, then I'm totally turned off. And if I'm not interested and someone who's teaching it is not passionate or is not great at what they do, then I have no interest again.
We're
right?
gonna try to hold your attention through the entire interview.
Okay, let's see how good you are.
Talk about how'd you get to computer science? Mm. You did decide to study in school. Maybe you didn't like school, mm-hmm. but that mattered a lot for what you ended up doing in your career.
I mean, I was like many kids back then, like playing Atari when I was young. I had a VIC-20, you know, which
was Commodore for anyone who doesn't know.
Yeah, Commodore VIC-20. You can look it up on the Wikipedia. So I had that, and we had like, we would try to create Dungeons and Dragons type games, if you remember Dungeons and Dragons and Magic
Very
Dice
well.
And all that stuff.
So 47-sided dice.
Yeah, that's awesome. Right. And so we would try to create games. They weren't really games, but we tried to create some logic puzzles and stuff like that on these different computers and record them all on cassette tapes because that's what you did. That was the media. And so that was interesting to me, probably because I'm naturally introverted, like that I can control and I like to master things, that you can master this thing. And so I like that. It kind of lent itself to my personality.
Yeah.
But when I went to Queens College, of course I studied accounting at the beginning, although I hated it. But you know, computer science was an overlap with accounting because there was this thing back then called information systems, which I don't think exists anymore, which basically taught you how to put stuff into Lotus 1-2-3 and other kind of accounting systems.
Sort of the dawn of this idea that accountants need to know computers.
Yes.
Right? Or so sort of in that.
So there was an overlap. And then, of course, I kind of geeked out on making things and using computers because I could master them. I could figure them out on my own.
Cool. Share a little bit of the story about how warehouse work influenced you and your work ethic.
Yeah, I had many crazy jobs.
What were you doing
up
in a warehouse as an accounting computer science student?
At first working in the summer. So my friend George, his family got knew someone who owned this warehouse. It was a cash and carry warehouse in Queens. And then I went to work there. And I was telling Eric that I was the only non-Chinese person that worked there. Everyone was from mainland China. And the owner, they never hired anyone who was not Chinese, but I got my friend's parents, who were Chinese, to talk them into letting me work there. And then the highest honor when I left was that Sam, who owned the company, said that I worked like a Chinese person. Right. So I had the work ethic of a Chinese person.
And he mentored you, right? I mean, it was sort of
He was kind of my like first mentor. His name is Sam Lee, and he was Taiwanese. And he actually owned a lot of these kind of businesses in the wholesale business in New York, but you would never know it. So I learned a lot from him. So he owned these businesses. They were called all different versions of initials of his last name. He would always say when people would come in that he was the manager and that the owner was in Taiwan, right? And so we can get into that later.
He didn't want to be the owner.
He didn't want people to know he was the owner of the business. But he had come from Taiwan. He had built these businesses. I don't know how big they were. They were, you know, multi-million dollar businesses, cash businesses. And he took, because I worked hard, he took a liking to me and kind of started to mentor me. And so I would do this warehouse work, but then I would also manage people. And then I would also do a lot of front office work that they had there. And at that time, he was teaching himself to program, and because you had to build your own systems, right? Like this is, there's no SaaS, there's no like going to, CompUSA, if you remember that. You had to build your own software.
QuickBooks probably wasn't readily out there.
No, so you built your own software. So he was building his own software, and so I would help him with that.
And what year are we talking about now, just to put it in perspective?
Are you trying to date me?
Yeah.
Let's see.
Because you're like marginally older than me, so it makes me feel good.
Early 90s. Very, very, very early 90s, the beginning of the 90s.
So you end up not finishing it. You're like many proud entrepreneurs, generation mm-hmm. of great entrepreneurs, you end up dropping out of school.
Oh, totally.
Talk about getting into tech. How did you get, I mean, yes, you were studying computer science, you're mm-hmm. helping Sam with his computer system. Mm-hmm. What was your first tech job? And
I worked for VAR, an ISV, which sort of don't exist anymore, which was in Manhattan, and I worked.
What of ours? Just tell in case anyone doesn't.
A value added reseller, right? Or integrated system vendor, right? ISV. So back then.
There was like no user experience for anybody who bought any products. So somebody had to go make
yeah,
that.
Yeah, so there were all these third parties that basically sold you a Cisco switch. They sold you a Nokia router. They sold you all the hardware that you needed for your office, right? And or for your company. And then because you couldn't get this stuff to work easily, they provided services around deploying this stuff. If you remember Novell and NetWare and all of that kind of stuff, they were kind of VARs of those systems and early Microsoft VARs. They mostly sold hardware and pretty nice sized company, and then a wholly owned. And then they had this application development group, which basically built software for other companies. And that's a group that I worked on. There was like five of us, and we created software for like Fox News and Citibank and lots of banks. If you work in Manhattan, you basically create lots of software for banks. And then you quickly find out like there's this whole large consulting layer in Manhattan especially that basically does all this work that internal developers and IT people within the banks don't want to do. Right? So they outsource all this work. There's tons, you work for Goldman, Citibank, you do all this kind of the work for these companies. And so I built a lot of that stuff. It would be called on-premise software at this point, right? You download it, you install it off physical media, and then you built this stuff. And then I hated it. You know, I didn't like creating that kind of software.
Yeah. I mean, really, when you think about it, like consumers went to stores and bought boxes of mm-hmm. software, mm-hmm. and businesses hired VARs.
Yes,
they didn't go to stores and buy boxes, but they hired VARs.
I mean, at that point, everything, whether you were a consumer or you were a business, you went through a third party, right? You never dealt with the company. You never bought from Cisco directly, right?
Cisco didn't want to deal with you.
No.
But why'd you hate it? I mean, it was your intro to tech. It ends up becoming sort of the beginning of a career. And I loved it, and that inspired me to go, no.
No, it was kind of boring because we were building software for these banks and these media companies, but there was no connection to the user within those companies. You'd build some awesome spec, you'd deliver something, maybe they used it, who knows, never know, right? You just like threw it over a wall and that was it. And so you were kind of like back here building software and just throwing it over a wall, delivering it at some point. Was it successful or not? I don't know.
But did you like the building software part of it?
Yeah, of course.
That was the part you liked?
Yeah, that part I liked.
So you're in New York from sort of mid-90s to the dot-com boom.
Yeah, 99.
Tell us about Silicon Alley and what that was like for young David Cancel.
I can't remember young David.
Yeah.
Let's see. So I left this company because I was obsessed with the early internet. And before that, I had been doing dialing into BBSs and bulletin boards, if you remember what those things are, AOL, CompuServe, Prodigy, all these kind of systems. And so that stuff was interesting to me. It was kind of Wild Wild West, and you were dialing in through like a 28.8 modem at that point, or 14.4. Yeah. And I don't know, there's something interesting about that, about the community and people all around the world, or at least all around the country on this thing. And so I started to build websites on my at night, just messing around with that.
What year was that?
1994.
So Netscape didn't exist?
No. Mosaic was around, you know. Mosaic was around back then.
Which was an academic project.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, so early websites, you know, they were all gray. You put your email address on the bottom of each one. You couldn't really have images on them. You had lots of bullet points.
Most people didn't have emails, so you didn't have to worry they were going to bother you.
No, there was no spam at that point. So you proudly put your email address at the bottom of these things. And so I did this, and I created these websites, and I created a geeky accounting website for Queens College.
To make your mom proud.
Yeah. And then I got emails, you know, that I read out on Terminal because of this website. And I got this one email from someone in Russia. And then they said, your site's really cool. And the way they found my site was because I submitted it to the What's Cool list back then. And so they found my site. They were like...
On Yahoo.
Yeah, on Yahoo.
Yeah, because Yahoo was really...
That was the only way. There was no real search at that point, just directory. So I submitted my site. Someone said, that's real cool. And I still remember that because that was the moment that everything changed for me. That was like, okay, this is what I want to do. And I think it was because it was this cause and effect. It was the first time that I saw cause and effect. Like, I built this thing. It was just a web page or a set of web pages. And someone saw it. They had a reaction to it. There was a human part of it. And they said, this is cool, right? And you got that validation back. So it was a feedback loop. And I had never had that building the other type of software, right, which bored me.
It's pretty cool. Like, this guy doesn't know that he changed that he
called. I know, some guy in Russia.
So if you get a chance tomorrow to tell somebody something they did was cool, you never know, it might change
exactly.
Their life.
So then, you know, because of that, I was like, I need to work on the internet, whatever that meant. That didn't really have a definition back then. And I checked news groups. I found these three people in Silicon Alley. It was not called Silicon Alley yet. It was just in Soho area of New York. I went and talked to them. Met up with them. I could code, and so therefore, you know, I joined the team and did all the coding, right? Because no one on the team could code.
And that was Concrete.
It was called Concrete Media, and it was three people: two founders and one girlfriend of one of the founders. Right?
And tell us, like, the scene. Like, maybe not at that moment, but what happened in the New York scene? What was that?
Oh, it was crazy.
That sort of .com 1.0. Yeah, feel it was, like
it,
in New York.
It was crazy. You know, everyone's coming from media, art. You know, which is normal in New York. And all these companies were springing up basically on one street in New York, up Soho, in Soho, on Broadway.
It's like House and Street South to Spring.
Yes, exactly.
Basically two blocks.
Two blocks, right? All these companies.
On Broadway, yeah.
Yeah, on Broadway, and then House. Later we moved to Varick off of Houston. But basically all these companies were on this one block. We were there, a company that was called Agency, which became a big agency, was starting up.
That was like the time of public company agencies. So
yeah,
that
yeah.
It was
big.
Was it important?
Razorfish was down the block, another one that became public. There was this company called Sudo on our corner, which was like early YouTube
sort of,
basically.
Yeah.
And then Jason Calcanis, who you may know now, had just gotten into the scene, and he created a news a magazine, a zine. We used to call him a zine, and it was called Silicon Alley Reporter. And he would publish this every month, and this was the beginning of the Silicon Alley scene. And so it was so small, we knew everybody. We knew the Razorfish guys, Agency guys, Pseudo guys. Baby Center was starting up in New York at the time. We basically knew everyone starting anything, and it was a tight little circle of people.
Including your wife.
Yeah.
Who was your girlfriend at the time?
I met her through Concrete Media. So Concrete Media started out as three people plus myself, and then we had this idea of like, oh, we're going to build websites for other people to make money, and then we're going to try to build our own, what we called community media properties on the web, right? Websites, right? Like social network sites.
Yeah.
But we didn't have those terms back then. We were coming out, everyone was coming out of media, so we had these fancy names.
But you invented Facebook. You think about filing a lawsuit?
Yeah, no, AOL invented Facebook.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Many things invented Facebook. But so we acquired this project from this woman who was in grad school at NYU ITP program, which is like New Media Studies. That became my girlfriend, who is now my wife. Sounds crazy, but you know, we acquired that.
But she was an entrepreneur really before you.
Way before me. I mean, she had created this site called girlsonfilm.com, which was for college-age women.
Sounds a little sketchy.
It sounds sketchy. The title's a little, you know, Duran Duran. But like, it was basically for 20-something-year-olds review films, right? And because this was one of the first websites.
So like clickbait.
Yeah, yeah,
title.
Yeah.
Okay.
Review. We were innocent back then. Yeah. We didn't even have that, right? That didn't exist on the web yet, right? And so, like, she created this site in grad school, and it got a lot of press, especially media press, because it was four girls starting this thing. It was an early website. Roger Ebert wrote stuff about this site and said Girls on Film is awesome. You know, New York Times, CBS, Morning Show, all this stuff. So she got a lot of press because of that. We acquired it and then built a team around that, technology team and what have you, and built that into what we call the Girls on Network. It was Girls on Film, Girls on Books, Girls on TV. There was a fourth one, which I still can't remember. And then that ultimately got acquired by Oxygen Media, which is a cable TV channel. They wrote my wife and her three friends wrote a book for HarperCollins. They did a TV show over there, what have you. And then while that was happening, we created an internal thing, which I worked on, which was called Bolt, BOLT.com. And I meet people all the time who were kids at the time who were like, oh, I used to use Bolt.
I love Bolt.
Yeah, and Bolt was like Facebook for teens back then. And we grew that and we had millions of users and we were like the second or third biggest community site according to Media Metrics at the time. And you know, our average user would stay on for 56 minutes on dial-up.
Wow.
Which is amazing,
yeah.
Right?
Some of that was once you dialed up, you felt like you needed to stay there for a long
gotta
time.
Stay all day.
It's a lot of effort.
And you know, we had all the stuff that you would see on Facebook today, and like you tag people and profiles and message boards and groups and all this kind of stuff, and clothing and stores and all that kind of crazy.
So the S-1 was registered.
Yeah, so we filed an S-1 to go public.
And then you walked away. And
then I left before that was supposed to go out.
It was a bit of a prequel for your future.
Yeah, so Bolt had been this small thing. And then by the time I left, I don't know, we were like 150 plus people. I was running technology for Bolt. I left because my wife's thing got acquired. She had gone to Oxygen. She was my girlfriend at the time. And she said, oh, I'm moving to Boston. Do you want to come? And I was like, okay. And so I left, right? And the backstory to that is I had never lived anywhere but New York. And so for some reason I had this thought that if I didn't leave New York now when my career was going awesome, I was probably never going to leave, right? Which is the story of most New Yorkers and most people.
Yeah.
Most of my family would never leave New York. And so I wanted to leave. Again, this is a more innocent time, right? And so I left.
But you're still a Mets fan.
Yeah, you know.
What'd you think of the Jay Bruce trade today?
I don't keep up with sports anymore. Yeah.
I should have prepared you more.
Yeah.
So okay, so let's talk about Boston. So yep. you come up to Boston. What was that transition like? I mean, comparing the communities at that time, what was that like?
I thought Boston was great from my standpoint in terms of like trying to build technology teams. You know, one of the hardest things, which I didn't touch on for Bolt and Concrete and Girls on Network, was that hiring engineers was impossible in New York at that point. And so when we started, we were in this loft in Soho, which is cool and looks like a movie and stuff, except there's no air conditioning, right? They leave that out of movies, right? And it's a walk up. You know, because the elevator never works.
Standing indoor air conditioners.
Yeah. We had one of those.
Oh, the standing
air conditioners. You know, with the water going out the window onto Broadway.
That's why you get wet. We're just walking on the street.
Exactly. And so, but then I would try to hire engineers, and all engineers would be working largely in banks and corporate. You know, they would be coming from their corporate job. Okay. They'd show up in a suit, and we'd be in there sweating, bullets working like 24/7. And basically, you know, we'd have to say, here's why you should get paid less, why you should join this startup. What's a startup again, right? This is pre-Yahoo, you know, going public. Really, what does this mean?
And you should leave Goldman Sachs.
Goldman Sachs, and we don't have a black car to drive you to work every day, and blah, 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 all these things. And it was like, you know, obviously we recruited a team, but it was pretty hard. And then I moved to Boston, and I thought, like, wow, there's so many engineers here. It's so easy to recruit, which relatively it still is.
Yeah.
So
we're going to have to fast forward a little.
Yeah,
let's go.
Because
there's a lot of...
A lot of history.
A lot of interesting stuff. So here's what I'm going to do to fast forward. I kind of planned this because I was like, how am I going to do all these hops? Tell me the kind of one sentence most important thing you learned at each of these places.
Okay. Yeah.
That's tough. Lycos had a labs group that hired you when you got to Boston. Mm-hmm. What was the main takeaway from that?
Couple. Well, at Lycos, it was interesting. You know, it was growing. We had just gone public.
And it's like one of the most important companies in tech at the time. Yeah,
definitely. And but, you know, I didn't understand anything about office politics and the CTO. I worked for the office of the CTO. I worked for him directly. And then there was a VP of engineering who's a friend of mine now, friend of ours now.
Yeah, I mean, he's a well-known guy in the community.
Well-known guy,
but
He stonewalled you at the time. He and the CTO who had come in through an acquisition hated each other. And so didn't know anything about those kind of bigger company dynamics and just thought, you know, that's where it reaffirmed, like, that I was an early stage guy.
Got it. Compete, which you really started at Idea Lab.
Yep.
What was the big takeaway from Compete? Compete ended up, but we should just share this for a moment, right?
Sure.
So web analytics becomes a pretty real business, ends up selling for $80 million or something?
$150 million.
Okay, so massively underestimating. Yeah. $150 million to WPP, right?
To WPP,
which is one, maybe the biggest agency in the world?
The biggest agency and market research conglomerate in the world.
Right. So we're gonna fast forward that experience, but you started this company that became a really interesting, important company.
Yeah.
What's the big takeaway from that part of your career?
You know, timing is important. Timing, which you can't control, is important, right? And so, like, we started Compete in post-bubble collapse 2000. So November of 2000, the bubble had collapsed in March of 2000, the spring. We started the company after that. We somehow miraculously raised a Series A when no one was able to. So we raised $6 million Series A from CRV. I'd say one of the things to learn is timing matters and pick your partner as well. And I had a great partner at CRV, right? And we shared the same partner, which really backed us and in some ways kept the company going when it shouldn't have been going. The first 3 to 4 years of that company were epic, super hard, and that gave me context for everything that I've done after.
We'll go back to the speed round in a second, but it's hard to just jump over Compete, or at least I'm having trouble doing it. So talk about walking away from Compete when you did. What was, you had founded this thing, it had size to it, I mean, it was a substantial company by the time you walked away, but you walked away. What talk about that experience.
Yeah, I mean, I think the way that I look back at all of my changes over time have been, you know, that my one thread is that I'm obsessed with learning. And then I look back at the times when I've made changes, we've either sold companies or left, and they've always been the same thing. When I felt like my progression stopped, and I felt like I wasn't learning anymore. I can articulate that now. I didn't see that pattern when it was happening, right? And so at Compete, we have gotten to this point where first 3.5 years were really hard. The next, you know, if we would have started the company in 2004, then it would have been pure hockey stick.
Right.
But we didn't. So 2004 through 07 were great, awesome. It was enterprise sales. It was hard. We did 80% of our revenue in the last 2 weeks of every year, a calendar year. So when everyone was trying to go on vacation, we were trying to not only renew, upsell, and we sold it.
I'm convinced SaaS was introduced just for better lifestyle for employees.
Way better. Yeah. I love SaaS. And we'd have to do it in those 2 weeks. And we sold to CMOs of large companies. And as you know, CMOs get fired every year.
Yeah.
Right? And so new CMO, upsell, and renewal happening over Christmas.
But if you don't mind, tell a story about the 5-year plan.
Oh, yeah.
Because I found that to be brilliant.
Yeah, we got to this point where, okay, 2007, we're getting interest by the company, and then we had brought in a great guy, who's another mentor of mine, to run the company, right? And at that point, you know, one of our competitors was about to go public, and everything was looking up, and you know, I talked to him, and he and the rest of the team wanted to, or some of the team, we were starting a plan for the future, and we started to talk about, or we had this conversation about 2012, which I still remember my.
And this is in 2007.
2007. And so, it was one of those surreal moments where, like, you hear someone talking, and then you're like, totally zone out, just like, did they just say 2012? And you're like, oh yeah, in 2012 we'll be this big, and all this. I'm just like, no way. There's no way. Like 5 more years. And at this time, we actually had interest to buy the company.
And Don came out of retirement to build a big business, but he had just gotten there, in a sense.
Yeah, in 2003.
And you had been there 7 years already.
Yep. And so,
so he had a great forward vision. You were just like,
I'm done. You know. Yeah, and then I think the rest of the management team felt in a similar way, who had been, most of the management team, except for him, had been there since we recruited in 2001. Around 2001, so they had been there for that length of time. We ultimately sold the company in 2007, 2008. I had already left at that point, found a replacement, recruited a replacement, and had left to run engineering. And then now, you know, everyone, including all our investors, look back and say, timing was amazing. It was good that we sold the company.
Right before the financial crisis.
Yeah, because the crash happened in 2008.
Macro's a bitch.
Yeah, macro's a bitch. So that's kind of meta lesson in Compete, which is the macro is a bitch. And so I always remember that when you talk to early founders and they're trying to optimize too much around like valuations and when they raise money and like maybe I'll stagger rounds and I'll do all this kind of stuff because I'll get the best valuation. And I like think is like, can't control the macro. Yeah. And the macro changes.
It's like
overnight.
Sailing, right? You can have a great sail, but if the wind goes out, if there's no wind, right?
It's over.
It's over. So, all right, good. Let's go back to Quick Hops here a little bit. What did you learn from Lookery?
Pick your partner as well. Yeah, so Lookery was, I started after Compete, kind of, and I started it on a, accidentally almost, or on a whim with a friend who lived in the Bay Area, and or a guy who I just met in the Bay Area, later became friends. And then we kind of ran this kind of bi-coastal company with half, or more than half the company being here, and some being in the West Coast, and both in Seattle and San Francisco. And that was definitely tough. I think, you know, the big lesson was my co-founder was allergic to raising venture capital. We raised angel, right? So there was not alignment there. And we had tons of opportunity to raise venture capital, but he was kind of allergic to it. And so ultimately left that business in his hands. And
just
he
too much misalignment wasn't going to work. What about Ghostery?
Yeah, so Ghostery was, there's so many companies.
This is why I have to quick hop them a little bit.
Ghostery, yeah.
And then there's this thing, Performable, we'll talk about.
There's other ones that I forgot. Like Ghostery was this thing that, this project that I started was a browser plugin. Basically, I created it just to geek out while at Lookery. I was trying to understand what third parties were running on a website. I thought nobody in the world cared about something that geeky, except for me. I had some friends in the Bay Area who saw me using it on my computer, my laptop, wanted a copy of it, so I released it in the Firefox app store, right, plugin store. And then
basically, you search the web, when you're using the web, you basically see everyone who's spying on you.
Yeah. So you go to every website and you see, oh, here's what's running on it. Facebook's here, and Google Analytics, and this ad tracker, and this thing, and all these kind of things. And so I created a nice little logo for it, gave it a cute name, and then I just released it on the App Store. And then, you know, in less than a year, I had 3 million people using it. And but still didn't think it was a business, right? Because it was just like this free, open kind of plugin. And then I released it in the Chrome Store. And about this time, I was thinking about starting a new company, which became Performable. And so I had a couple people interested in buying Ghostery from me, and I ultimately sold it to a company in New York called Avidion, who has since rebranded their entire company Ghostery, and now they have 30 to 40 million people using Ghostery at this point.
Pretty awesome.
Yeah.
And everyone here can download it.
It's free, ghostery.com. Just go there and download it.
Pretty cool. All right, so Performable, now we're getting into sort of recent tech history. we're in the midst of the, or sort of the back part of the financial crisis.
Yep.
What was Performable? Talk about what that was. What was the idea of Performable?
Yeah, so one of the first started out of frustration. So at Compete, we sold our product to CMOs, like I was saying. But one of the things that always frustrated me was that we'd sell to CMOs of all sorts of companies, like every travel company, most finance companies, Google, Ask Jeeves, Yahoo, eBay, all these companies were customers, in some cases, multi-million dollar customers. But we would sell them analytics and measurement about what their competitors were doing, and the same thing would happen every single time. And we'd go in and show them this thing, and they'd say, oh, that's amazing, that's awesome, that's exactly what we need to do. And then we'd say, so what are you going to do? And they'd say, nothing. And they'd say, so why did you spend all this money? Why did we do, oh, I need this to validate.
It's like McKinsey, you spend a lot of money and then you don't do any of it.
And why didn't do any of it? Because The marketer, had no one internal that could support them to do the work. And their agencies usually come in every 6 months, every year, and so they didn't have time. And so Performable, I thought, I never want to start another analytics company unless the analytics were tied to action that the marketer could take on their own, right? And so we had looked at the very high end of enterprise. Eloqua was already around doing marketing automation, but that was the very, very tippy top of the pyramid of enterprise. And we said, we're going to build a next generation marketing automation company. And that's what we did, right? So we built a marketing automation software, did all sorts of optimization and landing pages and all that kind of stuff. And we went to market in that first year.
And there have been some pretty notable companies since that have come out in that space that have become big companies, like... Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Mixpanel, or, you know, they were a competitor back then, Mixpanel, and there's a whole host of them, Amplitude, and all these companies that have come out of the Unbounce and Lead Pages and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Tons of companies in this space that we didn't even really know existed at the time, right?
But you sold the company after a little more than a year.
Yeah, a year
to
and
HubSpot.
A half.
So, you know, you had been a successful entrepreneur, you had wins along the way. Why did you sell Performable so early in its existence?
You sound like Izar, who was my my investor. You know why? You know,
it would have been so much easier to work with. But anyway,
yeah, that's a long story. You know, why why we sold it? You know, the answer is lots of reasons. Like, I didn't think we'd want to sell the company. Our investor and other investors who wanted to invest didn't want us to sell the company. We had more than half of the amount that we had raised in the Series A, which was a tiny amount, $3 million, but we had more than half of it still left. We had great customers, we had kind of momentum, and but we kept thinking, like, we want to build a company that is going to last in Boston. Like, I really felt like we could do that with Performable. We were incredible, I think, on product and engineering. We were just starting to learn marketing and sales and just trying to start to figure that out.
Yep.
HubSpot was this company that I knew the founders, I knew Dharmesh, I knew Halligan, I knew Volpe, I knew everyone in the company. More importantly, I knew the board. David Skok and Larry Bond, the Series A and Series B. I'd known them, some of them, all the way to 2000. And so,
pays to be in the community for a while.
Yeah, and so we had kept talking about possibly combining the companies, and I had said no. And then at some point I said, I think we should do it, because I think if we put the two companies together, because they were incredibly strong at marketing and sales, we were strong in product. If we put the two together, maybe we have the chance of building something that is lasting.
And they gave you 2/3 of the HubSpot business, right, in the deal?
2/3
of the cap table?
Yeah,
So
not quite.
Let's talk about it for a minute. How do you decide that? How do you work out, you know, look, they were a bigger business because they've been outselling, but you were the ones bringing product. They, you know, they were not as strong on product. How do you dance with porcupines in that moment? How do people how to merge that? I mean, we're one of our, you know, Uber and Didi merged their Chinese operation today, and you know, I understand it was quite a negotiation, right? Mm-hmm. And it's interesting to think about. So in your case, how did that come together?
That's a blur.
And they've been trying to recruit you before you even started Performable.
Yeah, well, they were trying to acquire the company since the beginning. Lots of back and forth, as you know, you've been through this.
Yeah.
So you know, there were certain things that were important to. To
but
me,
I've been through like a cash
us.
Acquisition, right? Mm-hmm. So then there's a price. It's a little more clear.
Sure, we had a price, and then we had kind of upside as well. You know, we had our investors who wanted us to raise the Series B instead, and the economics would be the same. But you know, we thought, you know, there were certain things that we wanted. We wanted to have control of product engineering and all of that stuff in the building, because that's what we thought we were strong at. We wanted to take our product, which was a mid-market product, their product at the time was a pure SMB product,
right.
And we wanted to see if we could merge the two and try to bring that market up, right? And so, you know, freedom, kind of creative freedom for an entrepreneur, super important, was one of the things that
so
we spent the most time on.
Operating understanding of terms.
Yeah, yeah.
Some of it's economic terms. So you just take the valuations of both companies and say, okay, this is the percentage ownerships?
Sort of. You know, they had just done a Series C. So
this is Sequoia's price, round.
Sequoia's round, yeah. Sequoia, Salesforce.
But if I was you, I might be looking at that and going, pretty overpriced round. You guys don't even have a good product. Mm. Or no? Because it was at a lofty valuation.
It was at a lofty valuation, but they had a good amount of sales at that point, and they had great momentum on the marketing and sales side. So yeah, there was going back and forth on this thing, but there were a lot of details that we spent a lot of time on.
All right, so tell us what it's like. You walk into HubSpot now. You're a much nicer guy than Ari Emanuel, but I, you know, I don't know if you ever saw the scene in Entourage where he takes over the agency and he, with a paint gun, just starts shooting paint at all the people he's always
hated.
Not
that much nicer.
No, but you're definitely a nicer guy. But what was it like? What did you discover when you arrived about the state of product and engineering and what you needed to do, and what did that look like?
Yeah, I'd say, you know, one is the company was, you know, amazing in lots of ways. Culture was amazing, momentum was amazing, marketing and sales amazing, services getting pretty close, but needed a little work. And then product engineering was obviously the lagging part. I'd say the way that everyone characterized it before I got there was that there was like this vision problem, and that we needed kind of this product vision person, and you know, we needed leadership on the product vision side. But you know, scale was happening from a purely marketing and sales standpoint, and so like there was no problem in the vision, right? And so it was pretty quick to say like,
so they were selling the vision just fine.
Yeah, that was selling all night long, but like all day long. What was missing was like the execution of the product, and why was that happening? And
but if it's selling, how do you see that in the metrics? Like, where does it show up that the vision's fine but the product's not?
Churn.
So the churn was really high, and that was really obvious.
Yeah, the churn was high.
Were
really
they
high.
Sharing that right off the bat? I mean, did you know that going into the merger?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we knew everything was totally open. Everything. There was no surprises on that end. I'd say all the surprises that we discovered were surprises to a lot of people. And so, you know, I think, I don't know, there's, you know, I thought I was data-driven before this experience, and then I saw, like, wow, you could take data-driven all the way. And so I said, I think data-driven probably too extreme in some cases, and then you rely on metrics, and then, but if you don't properly design your metrics, and then you don't, then you incent people to do the wrong things, or you kind of spend a lot of time in gaming, right? A lot of gaming, and so how do you correct gaming? Then we add new game, we create new rules, and then they figured out the game, how do we fix it again? Create new rules. And so like, these are like, if not designed well, the metrics that you're going after, kind of byproducts of being too data-driven. And so I'd say that was probably, at first it seemed like things should be working, and then you, from a product engineering side, we dug in, and then there were obviously problems.
Well, when you got there, did you experience anything like what Dan Lyons wrote about in his book?
I didn't read his book, so.
Anything like the summaries you heard about of what Dan Lyons wrote about in his book?
You know, my only takeaway from his book was I heard the summaries and I thought, you know, there were probably, in any given company, there are a lot better stories than are in this book, but I guess he's a good writer. So I'd say, you know, there weren't any very good stories in that book. Yeah.
Got it. And there was a lot of turnover in the product and engineering group when you came.
Yeah.
What was that like? Both, did anyone think you were a madman? Did at some point Brian try to stop you? Did you come under a lot of scrutiny for that? What was it like making that those changes?
Yeah, it was emotional, right, at the time, right? There were a lot of people there who'd been there for a long time, and they were nice people and are nice people, and so a lot of, I'd say I give a lot of credit to Brian and the board because they basically let me take full control of that. And, you know, hard to do in a company that, you know, is north of 2,500 customers, momentum, and say, we're gonna reboot all of this.
Right.
We're gonna rewrite the entire product, and we're gonna reboot the team, and we're gonna do all this. That's pretty hard, especially you've been with a lot of these people for a long time. But we needed to do that. We went through that progression, and then we, you know, a lot of it was obvious, you know, like Silicon Valley. I don't watch that show, but like how I hear that show.
Apparently anything Dan Lyons, you keep your distance.
Yeah, and so like, you know, like come in and be like, no one's working, what's going on here? You know, like looking around. And so all of it, you can just see like, okay, everyone here is coding, but no one's typing. So like, how do we make code, right? I don't need to be a genius, but if like no one types, if I look at someone all day and they've never like hit a key.
And when you remove their keyboard and they don't notice.
Yeah, and this is the only key that they hit like this, and I'm just like, something's wrong. And if you come in at 11 and leave at 2:30 and you only hit like a key a couple of times, like, and I'm sitting next to you and I'm watching you watch YouTube all day, and just like, what are you doing? Watching YouTube? Oh, okay, all day? Okay, yeah, why? I'm done. What do you mean you're done? It's like the first week of the month. Oh yeah, I committed, you know, there was this agile methodology. I committed this many points this month. I already fulfilled my points. So what are you going to do all month? Nothing. I already did my, what? You know, so I felt like, you know, I felt like I really went through this period in the first like 2 months where I would just ask myself, like, am I crazy? Because everyone around me thinks this is normal.
In the entrepreneur world, this happens a lot, right? You're starting a company and everyone thinks you're crazy. Like, you have to constantly ask yourself, you know, like everyone's trying to warp the universe in some way. So are you. And am I crazy? Is it just me? Totally. Everyone seems to think something but me.
They're this is fine. This is cool. Yeah, look, I hit this number here. I can do nothing for the next 25 days. And it was like, what? What's going on here? And yet, you know, at the same time, high churn, customers mad, internal customers, you know, not happy. And so obviously some of that was, you know, my conclusion, too far gone. There's some stuff that you can try to correct. We tried with half. And then there's some stuff that's so far, like if someone just watches YouTube all day for, and their day consists of 4 hours, and no matter what you say, there's no problem with that. Like, I don't know how to, we can't meet halfway, right? And so we had to go through that process.
So in New York, in the 90s, you left Bolt right as the S1 was coming out. Compete, you left before the acquisition. You would think that HubSpot, you might want to stay through the IPO.
Nope, I left. Yeah. So I was there a little over like 3.3 years, right? 3.5 years, let's say. And I left officially a couple of weeks before we went public.
You want to see what that was like?
No. Yes and no, no. No, really, because, you know, my thing was with Compete, we had gotten, and Bolt, we had gotten, let's say, 150, close to 200 people. Yeah. My team at HubSpot was close to that size in itself. And I felt like I had seen what I really wanted to see was this rapid scale from 200 employees, which was around the size when I got there, to over 1,000, to, you know, multiple offices here, Australia, Dublin, what have you. Yeah. So I had seen this like scale, and I didn't feel like that I was necessarily wanted to learn the lessons, all the lessons of being a public company, and I didn't want to have to stay for another 2 years to learn those lessons. So I thought this was, and I had been bringing in people. I had elevated 2 people to VP positions, VPs of product. I had brought in outside VP of engineering, and so like I had everything in place, so the timing was good for me to leave.
Do you feel like you learned anything about sales and marketing in a good way from the time
amazing.
You spent?
Yeah, so much, right? So, you know, I look back and think it was an amazing experience. I learned so much sales and marketing side, and so did everyone, because the whole inside sales model and that whole industry kind of grew up around the same time, right? And so a lot of these things you can, again, you know, like now you can go read Jason Lemkin, or you can read some book or whatever.
And there's a lot of stuff that seems obvious.
Obvious
later.
Now. Yeah. But like in 2009, when we were starting Performable, and then, you know, close to 2011 when we sold Performable, there was no Jason Lemkin writing on Quora, right? So a lot of this stuff was like mysterious, and we were still figuring it out, right?
Like
so,
what's good churn?
Yeah, no one knew. Like,
Is this too high or is this not too high?
And is it pure MRR churn, or can we offset it with upgrades? Like what, you know, like what are, is it dollar churn or is it customer churn? Like what are we looking at?
Did you see that churn start to go down very quickly, or was it a real process? Was there, did it require a lot of patience? I mean, I know you said churn was one way we could see something needed to be changed, and it did change, right? Because now it's a public company. We could all see the churn
was
pretty low.
Yeah, yeah.
What was that? Was that a, like, did that require you begging patience from people, or was that a few things you had to fix and it really started moving quickly?
No, it was, you know, first it was all company kind of thing. So we had to change the way we sold, we changed the way we serviced, we changed the way we priced and packaged. We changed all of the products where we rewrote 150% of the product because we went up market, we went into new industries like sales, right? We rewrote everything. There was not one stitch of anything that existed when we got there pretty quickly. So that was a long process. And then migration of thousands of customers, very long process. So the answer is yes, we saw things change pretty quickly, but in pockets and in segments. And so why it was important to look at things from different cohorts and then look at things from different segments, SMB, mid-market, enterprise, you know.
And they spoke analytics, so they were very comfortable.
Yeah, so we had been looking at all that. Yeah. We had been measuring customer NPS from very early times, employee NPS. So we had all of these things that we could calibrate and see, okay, new cohorts are getting better. Old cohorts look the same, right? But new cohorts are coming onto the new software. We still haven't migrated the old ones. Those are starting to look good, right? And it was like month after month after month, looking at every cell and seeing the color change in those cells.
Yeah, and if you've read David Scott's blog, you can imagine how detailed this must have been.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
So a lot of that blog is HubSpot.
That's right. Yeah. So you left to start Drift.
Yeah.
Pitch us Drift.
Drift is so good, you don't have to pitch it. Yeah. That's how good it is. So Drift basically helps back to what we were talking about early on, which is this concierge concept, right? So with Drift, we think the way that people want to interact with your business is fundamentally changed. And we think that people want to be treated like a human, right? They want to be treated like an individual. And this whole process that we've been a part of, that we've helped create, this whole process of filling out forms and, you know, getting routed to salespeople and people hassling on the phone and all of this kind of crazy, crappy experience that we all go through that we all hate as individuals, but we, as soon as we get to work, we build these systems and we help create some of those systems. We think that system is flawed, and so we think there's a new way for companies to be doing marketing, and we're trying to build that. And it's all about having that personal experience and having facilitating the company and the customer having that conversation. And kind of the analogy that we use all the time is that imagine you walked into the Apple store or your favorite store. I like the Apple store, so we'll use that as an example.
Yep.
And you walked in and you said, and you saw someone standing there and you said, I want to buy this laptop. And they wouldn't talk to you and they'd say, go fill out this form on this kiosk. They just point at this kiosk and you fill out, type in your stuff. Let's say it's an iPad. You fill it out. Okay, now can I talk to you? No. Read this literature that we have for you, otherwise known as an ebook. Okay, read another one. Okay, can I talk to one? No, go home. What do you mean go home? Okay, someone will call you. If you qualify, at some point we will qualify you, we'll route you to a right salesperson. Days later we'll call you on the cell phone when you're out with your wife at dinner, and then we'll try to get you reinterested in our product. That is the state of the art of every website and business app, product, what have you, in the world. That's the best that happens today.
It's the marketing to sales handoff.
Yeah, and we think that whole process is broken versus you walking into the store and saying, hey, Eric, you were here last week. Hey, do you want to, can I help you? Yes, okay, here's a personal experience. Hey, you were talking to Bob last time, let me bring Bob over, right? Why can't we have that experience on every single business website and product today? We can, and Drift is trying to power that.
So I would totally fund that.
Yeah, okay, you did.
Sort of. So talk about raising money before you're sure what business you want to exactly go into.
Sure.
And you raised $15 million before you decided exactly what business you want to go into. Talk about that decision and how you thought about it and frankly, whether you'd recommend that if somebody can pull it off.
You know, someone can pull it off is probably the key part. So super fortunate. So we, you know, after leaving HubSpot, didn't know what I'd do next. Would I even start another company? Would I retire? What would I do? And thought, I still have something to prove. I still want to start another company. And if I'm going to bother starting another company, we're going to go for it. At this time, Elias, our VP of engineering at HubSpot and my co-founder at Performable, left as well and said, we're going to start a new company. What does that company do? We don't know, right? So how are we going to start it? We'll just fund it ourselves, right? Okay, and so the best thing to do in terms of raising money is to tell investors that you don't need any money, right?
Especially when you've made investors a lot of money before.
Exactly, this, I think in dating this is called a neg, right? But this predates me, right? Because I'm pre like internet dating.
Yeah,
me
too, yeah.
So, you know, so we had great investors and I love working with them and so they were, basically asking if we wanted to take money. And so I thought about it and I said, like, you know, I'm not going to raise a little bit of money like we did at Performable, $3-5 million, which is a lot. I don't want to say it's a little bit. But we know what SaaS economics look like, and we know we're going to have to build the kind of company that we want to. We will have to raise money at some point. If we can raise a lot of money, who knows what a lot of money is at the time, from the right people who we've worked with before, who we can trust, and who we can say, we don't know what we're building yet, right? Do you want to do it or not? If you don't, that's okay. If we can do that, then we will, right? At the right valuation, of course, all these things. And fortunate because you know, our old friends decided to invest, including Eric. Sight unseen, we had no deck, we had nothing. And my answer was, you know, the same. Like, we don't have anything. Say, oh, do you have a deck? No.
I asked, do you want like
me?
5 times.
Yeah, yeah. Do you want me to make one up, was my answer. And so I felt like, you know, different place in my life, right, and different relationship with these investors. Like, here's what I know. Whatever I put in that deck, you know, I know, it's going to be wrong. So you want me to make up some Excel spreadsheet with some model in it? I can make it up. I know the minute I leave, it's wrong. You know it's wrong. So if we want to go through this like dance, we can go through the dance. But like, but I'm not going to waste my.
But that works because you have a lot of credibility.
Absolutely. I don't suggest.
I think for most entrepreneurs, the way they generate their credibility is by how thoughtful they are about the business they want to start.
Sure.
And not say, I mean, you were maybe thoughtful in that moment, but not yet on those topics.
We were thoughtful in that saying that, you know, we have a model, which is this customer-driven model, which we started Performable. We kind of perfected or honed at HubSpot. It's how we built everything. And then we were going to use it at Drift. And that model was that we identify a customer type, we work with that customer, and we continue to iterate every day with that customer, and that's the way that we build teams, that's the way we build products, that's kind of our philosophy, and we would have the same, right? So we weren't off in space somewhere working on something, and then someday we were going to release it. Our model was rapid experimentation with feedback
and,
in the market.
And we know how to do this.
Yeah, we know how to do it.
But I want to say for the entrepreneurs in the room who are working their butts off, know exactly what they want to build and are struggling to raise money, mm-hmm. Who think, boy, that seems so unfair, I think I would say to them, struggle for 20 years.
Yes, right? Struggle for 20 years,
And make money for people and you will, too. I mean, I think that's, but it is really unusual.
Super unusual.
I'm trying to think of another scenario that we've ever done that as a fund.
Yeah.
So it's very unusual. Okay, so how do you not burn money fast when you put that much in? Most companies, they sort of extrapolate their burn rate from, you know, 12 to 18 months, we're going to use up this money. $15 million from the start's a lot of money.
Yeah.
How do you manage that? Like, gate how fast to move? Because another engineer will let you go faster, but it doesn't mean you're going faster toward the right thing.
Yeah, I don't think they will. One, I'm cheap.
Or at least better coffee will make you go faster.
Yeah. These guys are giggling. This Drift team over here, they'll tell you, cheap.
Is he cheap?
Yeah.
Really cheap? You just say cheap once. Not really cheap. Yeah. I'm really cheap. That's okay. Doesn't bother me. So I'm really cheap. And so you know, even having $15 million, I have to, or any amount of money, kind of struggle to spend money, right? I'm still that same kid, right? And I have been through multiple downturns on the macro, right? And so I've had to compete, you know, during that first 3 years, lay people off, right? Never want to do that again, right? I've had to, at that point, I was in my mid-20s and laying people off who had families who, you know, not to get, we'll bring it back up, but like laying them off in a market that I knew 100% this person is getting a job for a year. I know that, right? And they have a family and they came here because they trusted me, right? We had nothing else because I talked them into coming to this company. And so you do that enough times and shit gets real fast, right? And so because of that, that taught me this discipline of, no, we're going to be tight, we're going to be cheap. There's a point that we're going to need to use this money to scale, but we're not going to waste it in the beginning. And so, fortunately, I have no problems saving money.
So how long has it been since you raised money?
In the fall, in October, it'll be 2 years.
Okay, and how many people on the team?
A little under 20.
So you've kept it pretty tight?
Yeah.
Okay, you set up an office across the street from HubSpot.
Not on purpose.
Good, so I want to talk about this. And you've recruited a few people, not a lot, from HubSpot. What's the relationship
maybe
like?
Maybe half the team.
So, and the press has decided to have a little fun with this. But hearing it directly from you, what's the relationship
fantastic.
Like between the companies?
Yeah, great. So, you know, pretty much everyone on the management team at HubSpot invested personally in Drift. Brian, Dharmesh, et cetera. Volpe, Roberge, like all of them are involved or have been investors into Drift. And we're a partner of theirs and we're right across. And obviously we have some people that used to be at HubSpot on the team. It's been fantastic. So I didn't set out to have an office directly across the street. Yeah. Like, you know, I actually looked at 30 offices to actually find an office that was not across the street. And everything fell through. And in the last minute, our realtors, T3, found this space. And they said, you're not going to like it.
We really do believe you.
Yeah, yeah. And so we took this space. Yeah.
All right. So I want to talk about generalist sort of founder advice.
Sure.
Okay. You're advising 24 some odd startups, a bunch of VC funds. What's sort of your unique perspective? What are you, I mean, if you just thought of a couple themes, what are things you believe that not everyone believes about the startup world?
Mm, nice. Thelian question. I believe, you know, one is that, let's see, what do I believe? I believe that...
Where are most of us wrong? Whether VCs or entrepreneurs, or in your opinion?
Yeah, I think people, most entrepreneurs that I meet are wrong in this kind of obsession about ideas. And so those are the ones that scare me the most, right? Who are just like, I got some idea, Eric. And it's just like, oh, what's the idea? And you talk to them and you can see almost in their eyes that they're like hell bent on this idea. And I think like Hollywood and makes Hollywood or media or whatever you want to call it, make up this story of this, the idea of this person in the lab who, you know, goes to the shower and they have this idea, and then, you know, 24 months later, that's a public company worth 50. That's never happened.
And I use Hollywood as an example in the opposite all the time, where I say, just think of any just high level three sentence plot line of any movie. Could you say whether that would be a good or bad movie? You can't.
You can't.
It's all about the design and execution of the movie. It's not, you know, I want to do a movie about a developmentally disabled guy who meets a lot of people throughout history and does a lot of important stuff. Well, that's like, Forrest Gump. But, you know, like,
sounds awful.
Is that, it sounds terrible, right? Yeah. And, but, you know, it's great music, and they got all the great 60s music.
Still sounds
and
bad.
Good acting, and it, well, maybe you never liked the movie, but I thought it was a great movie.
It was a...
So, but it, but I try to use that analogy, but somehow I think, like, also the, you know, you've got Shark Tank and stuff that sort of emphasizing
this weird thing. And I feel like, well, one, if you like look at anyone in who goes through a scientific process, right, you'll see that this has never been the case, right? It's a game of iteration. So on the science side, you can see this, but you can see it all the way on the art side. You're a writer, you're a painter, you're a creator of something. It's always an iterative process. It always has been. And the thing I try to tell entrepreneurs is that at this point, I've probably met thousands of entrepreneurs that you've probably met way more. And I say, I've never, ever, ever met one who even knows of someone with this mythical thing of just like, I had an idea and that idea was a thing. It's never been the case.
Those are the patent trolls.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I had an idea and I created something because I wrote a patent.
Yeah, so those are not entrepreneurs. But it's never been the case. Like, every single thing, the first version has never been the final version. It's never existed. And so I just don't believe in that, but I think a lot of people do.
Question for the MBAs in the crowd. You said, hell no, I'm never going to hire an MBA. And you have a job search right now for an MBA.
No, I didn't say that. I said, you don't need an MBA to start a company.
Oh, okay. Not hell no, I'll never hire
an
MBA.
I never said
I don't
that.
Know where, okay.
Yeah. I said, so I wrote this, like, do you need an MBA to start a company? Hell no. Right?
Okay.
Yeah, so.
Okay, why are you looking for an MBA?
Good question. So we're looking for an MBA now.
This is meant to be like a recruiting moment for anyone
so,
who's looking.
You know, I got to work with this this person at HubSpot, actually, who came in.
Did you bring an HR person we can direct everybody to? Who's
no,
interested?
I'm the HR person.
Okay, good.
Yeah, yeah. And so I worked with this great guy who was an intern at Sloan at HubSpot in the early days, and then kind of like worked his way up and got to work with him a long time. And he owned mostly pricing and packaging, that kind of stuff. Kind of saw the value of that. I also saw the same thing, which is like, it's hard for that to be a full-time role. You have to kind of grow and kind of earn your way inside the organization. Yeah. And most people who are graduating from an MBA program want to go straight to the top, right? Like, how do I break into an early stage company, and how do you become a leader there, and how do you do all these things? And it's, you know, my thing was, I don't have an answer. I don't know of any company where you could do that. Late stage company, growth stage company, there might be pockets of opportunity, but
early
like
stage startup,
early stage, never. And so, had been thinking about the stage that we're at, and had this experience in the back of my mind, and said, okay, what about if I put that together and say, we're going to recruit the same kind of model of this person that I worked with. I'm going to give someone a chance to actually break into a startup, into the early stage game, and they'll have to earn their way up. And by doing so, they'll either earn a leadership role within the team, or they'll go start their own company, and I'll be the first person to help fund that company. But anyway, they would have gained access into our network, into our world, and kind of earned and saw this early stage thing firsthand.
So it's a really good gig.
It's an amazing gig.
So compare, and then I have the rapid fire stuff for you. Compare dot-com 1.0 to today for a moment. You know, I think I went through both. I think you had an even deeper view of both. What do you think? Are we in a similar moment? How does it feel similar and different?
It feels, I mean, any kind of build up kind of starts to feel the same, but it feels different in that because there's actual money flowing through the system that's coming outside. There's a lot of money. Yeah, there's a lot of money that flows in between companies that no one talks about. But there's money coming from outside of that business and coming from individuals, you know, actual individuals,
right,
which didn't exist in the first thing. So it's hard to kind of draw parallels and say, like, this one's going to blow just like the last one. Things are overheated, definitely, in some areas, right? And, you know, some people who have been through the first and have gone through this kind of hope for a pullback, right, in some ways, especially in the hiring side, because you have a lot of people who've come into the market, into this startup market, who came into the market post 2009, right? So have no context and just think like,
this is a fun place to be. It always goes right.
This is amazing, and it's just like, and then when I talk to them, and they're just like, oh, I should start a company in this, and I'm like, starting a company is insane, right? Like starting multiple companies. Super insane, right? Like, it's crazy. It's hard. What? It's not hard. Silicon Valley, this, that, whatever. And it's like, no, this is like for crazy people. It's really hard. And it's like, why do you want to do this? I hope it's not to make money, because there's a lot easier ways to make money than this.
Yeah.
This is a hard way to make money.
To be fair, I think it is even hard. It's always hard.
Yeah.
Right? And the truth is, it's always hard. Mm-hmm. It's just easy. It's wind in sails versus not wind in sails, right? It's and when there's no wind in the sails, it's brutal.
Brutal.
You can work so hard, you can do such a good job, and it's brutal. All right, rapid fire. I'm going to name a bunch of things.
Okay.
Just give me a sentence. Mm-hmm. Sam Walton.
My favorite book, my mentor as an author. So Sam Walton, founder of Walmart, super cheap. I think I get my cheapness from him. Yeah.
Ted Dinnersmith.
Legend. You know, my another mentor of mine, and Ted Dinnersmith was my and Eric's investor at Compete and at Brontis, and just I don't know, someone that I went through those dark years with at Compete, who stood by us, and I always thought, like, why is he still here? Why hasn't he given up? And you know, was kind of fundamental in helping form me and form that company.
Ted's the best. Mm-hmm. Mozilla?
Communist. Oh, so
why?
So I had a So Mozilla, I dealt with the Mozilla Foundation, makers of Firefox, a lot when I did Ghostery. And they just annoyed me because at the time I was trying to figure out if I could do anything commercial with Ghostery. And Mozilla had this hypocritical stance, in my view, where they had one sugar daddy, which was Google, that was giving them $56 million a year in kind of ad money.
Paying for search rights in their browser.
Yeah, and then they expected everyone who built software for their browser to be open source and never to monetize, and how dare you even think of monetization? Let's just do this for the love of the community. And so I had a lot of back and forth with them. And then Chrome, made by Google, opportunistically jumped on and kind of created an ecosystem where developers could actually make money, and took the market away from them.
Mm-hmm. Tech in Boston podcast.
Where I met Dave Gerhart, who's sitting in the front here, who joined.
It's another product placement, but.
Yeah, another product. Great podcast. Truthfully, I had not listened to it before I was on Tech in Boston.
But it's worth, but
it's
good,
worth, it's awesome, it's
always.
Awesome. Pro Boston. You know, I'm kind of like 50-50 on the whole Pro Boston thing, which we've talked about.
Oh, that's my last one.
Okay,
HubSpot.
Epic company, great experience, yeah.
Super proud of it.
Super proud. Yeah.
Big future.
Mm-hmm.
Not making a forward-looking statement, but big future.
Huge future.
All right, Boston tech scene?
Great. I mean, I'm here. I love Boston. But I just, Eric and I had this conversation, and I'm kind of like, the way that I think about Drift is like, I'm trying to build a global company. Like, I'm not building a Boston company. I'm building a global company that's proudly headquartered in Boston. And, you know, this is, I spend a lot of time talking to investors, like Eric, and and angels, a lot of angels who are like, how do we bring back Boston? How do we make Boston awesome? And obviously Dave has tech in Boston and Boston and Boston. I feel like the more that we talk about like Boston, 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 the more it sounds like we're like the Chamber of Commerce in Iowa and says like, we just got a great new business in Boston. It's kind of like, feels like self-defeating in some ways. I understand the reason for doing it, I think there's great things in Boston, and I've never, you know, I moved from New York to Boston and think like only the upside in Boston.
Great, we should open it up to some questions. So there's at least one mic going around. If you put your hand up and that mic finds its way to you, ask a question. If you don't put your hand up, the mic won't find you. And I do cold call. So hopefully somebody will ask a question. All right.
See you, Vig.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. One of the team walking out. Tough.
Yeah.
Tough. Tough crowd.
Hi, Neil Karasik. I think at one point you said you don't hire product managers for product positions. Have you broken that rule?
I've hired some product managers, people who've had, so I wrote this post like why I don't like hiring product managers as product managers. And the reason it's complicated, but I'd say one problem with the product manager role, which a lot of recent MBAs actually want to be a product manager, which I find interesting, is that it means...
I advise them that's a good idea. Yeah.
We'll talk about that later. Yeah. I think it's a weird... It's this weird role that means something totally different at every single company that I talk to. And then I ask the company, what's the difference between a product manager, program manager, right, project manager? Tell me the difference between whatever. And depending on the company, they'll tell you some weird combination of those things. And so I always found like trying to hire a product manager was either they were a project manager, they were a program manager, they didn't know what they were. They were not my definition of a product manager, and I think a product manager definition is very localized to the company. It's very different than engineering, very different than other roles, and so what is their influence? And so because of that, I didn't have good success hiring people who come from a product management background to only untrain them in what they thought product management was at their last role. And so I hired people who looked more like startup founders, people who were maybe came from a different role. Like Mark, we were building marketing software at HubSpot, so we moved some people from the marketing team who were the user, right? They were our persona and we had good success moving them into as a product manager. We moved people out of support into product management. Just found different ways to
not
bring people in.
No,
I mean there were some engineers that thought about doing product management. But we had different tracks for them. I think. Some engineers could be excellent product managers. And our version of product management was kind of a peer to the tech lead, which ran the engineering team. And their job was to be the product manager, to be super customer facing and be out ahead of the team. And I found, again, when I talked to a lot of product managers, they think product management is managing stuff in Trello and Excel spreadsheets and like Gantt charts and all this stuff. And it's just like, that's not going to move the needle. And the stuff that we're trying to do, it's nice, but it's not going to move the needle. Our job is, and our method is this customer-driven method, and if we're not out in front of the customer every day, then we're losing ground, and the system doesn't work, right? It's one of the checks and balances that we have is, we call it guardrails. It's one of the guardrails we have is that we need to be out ahead of customers, and if we're not talking to customers, then the whole system doesn't work, right? So because of that, I try not to hire product managers.
Customer advocates.
Yeah, that's better.
Right? To me, that's what it's supposed to be, and what you described is really a project manager. But anyway, next question. Yeah, get the mic.
Thanks for a very inspiring story. I have it's my ignorance that I don't know much of your history about all the companies that you left, but it looks like you always left right before the IPO, and then. I mean, according
to Eric.
So do you have any exit strategy advice? I mean, as to like to stay on a little longer, or maybe you made a lot of. Obviously, you made money for the investors, but have you made money for yourself that could be better?
A little bit.
You have like exit phobia. Like you'd rather exit yourself before the company exits.
Yeah. So it's a weird thing. Have I made money for myself? Yes, lots.
Yes, of course.
But could I have made more money?
Yeah, that's a question.
Definitely.
Yeah.
I've left a lot of money, a lot of money on the table many times. But, you know, here's the love of the game part, right? Like, I'm not motivated by money. And because I'm not motivated by money, somehow I've made money, right? Because it was not my motivation. And so I never optimized for this kind of like this transaction or how much dollars I was going to make out of something. And my thing was that I was trying to build a company. I was trying to build something of value, and the money was a byproduct of that. And I felt like, sure, in a lot of these scenarios, I could have made a lot more money. I don't need any more money, to be honest. But like, I could have made more money, but maybe I wouldn't have done the next thing. I wouldn't have learned the next thing. And the learning was the important thing to me, maybe different for everyone, than the money. So,
I mean, to be fair, right, the IPO and the acquisition is a re-sign up in most cases.
Yes,
right,
and totally.
You do have to decide going into those processes.
Absolutely.
A lot of people want to be there for it,
yeah.
But you have to kind of decide going into any of those processes that I'm re-signing up in most cases.
Good point. So no one ever talks about this. This is like the hidden mafia conversation. You're about to go public in a company. You have lots of conversations about like, you're here, right? You're not leaving, right? Because if you are
like
leaving, then you have to disclose.
Yeah.
You have to disclose it, you know, when you're going out as a known, as an issue that someone may leave, right? If there's any inkling of you're leaving, so you're staying. And so if you're a commitment phobic entrepreneur, that's like a weird time of like, you're never gonna leave, right? You can't leave for a long time. So it is a re-sign up. No one talks about the, you have to sign up.
And acquisitions too, usually if you're key to the team and you're not expendable by the acquirer, they make a big issue of are you staying as well.
A big issue. So yeah, so could there be more money? Sure. And then I look at many Excel spreadsheets that said, look at all the money you're gonna leave if you leave. Yes, many, and I said,
get some project managers to make those for you?
No, CEOs and board members. But you know, in terms of trying to get you to stay, right? And so who cares? I'm not doing it because of that.
Let's do two more questions. I think we're okay for two more questions.
Thank you, David. So it sounds like there was an incredible amount of foresight in the skills and industries that you specialize in that kind of pivoted your career. Mm-hmm. Is there anything in terms of skills and industries aside from digital marketing, digital media, that you would recommend for us as we look to make the next transition in our careers?
Good thing. There was no foresight, none at all. Just interested in change and learning, and these were the areas that were growing the most. And so I was really excited about those things. I don't know, I'm really interested in some of the stuff we're doing on machine learning, AI, that whole kind of the whole data. Actually, I won't even call it those buzzwords, but how do we take the data that is now accessible and is now at scale and actually make it useful, right? And so I have this, I'm gonna try to write a talk around this, which I think we talked about a little bit, which was like, there's been a lot of transformation that has happened because of technology, but to date, a lot of it hasn't led to the productivity boost that we think it should have. Yeah. It's just been a transfer, right? It's been a transfer from maybe like blue collar to white collar, from this country to that country. It's just a transfer of the problem, right? We haven't seen the efficiency yet, but I think now that we're at scale with this data, we have the opportunity, if we use it correctly, that we can see some efficiencies there. So I think there's this whole new transformational wave coming, and because of new markets and new access to data and new technologies that I'm super excited about, and it has everything to do with, although I hate Pokemon, AR, or you know, I don't know about VR so much, although I've had an Oculus since, you know, long time ago, and Magic Leap and all these kind of 3D things. I don't know the application yet, but AR is really interesting to me, and obviously mobile, we're at the tail end of that, and then now use of data, pretty interesting.
But for what it's worth, I think what you were saying at the beginning is something I deeply believe, which is find things that get you excited, if it's advice, right? Find the thing you're really passionate about, because doing it because other people think it's interesting is never gonna get you there, and then go to the edge of the innovation on that, right? There's room for innovation almost everywhere. And if you push to, okay, what's the really interesting things going on in this space? And it can even be accounting software. You can push those edges and create a lot of value.
No, never, it can never be accounting software.
Everything but accounting software.
But I think you're right there. Like one thing that I talk a lot about is like to learn to listen to your intuition, and this is part of your intuition, right? Like you find an area that really you think is fast moving, you're really, really interested in, maybe that's enough. Maybe that's enough to actually deep dive into it. And I find like the smarter someone is, the more they try to push to the quantitative side and try to talk themselves into things. Market's this big, this opportunity is this big, all these numbers.
Like,
and we
check boxes.
Yeah, and we do this for hiring people, we do this for decisions we make at work, we do this every day, and then we convince ourselves to say, oh, we're gonna do this because of all of these macro things that are happening, even though from an intuition side or from a gut standpoint, I have no interest in doing this stuff. You kind of rationalize.
Or vice versa, where your conviction's telling you to do something, but you're overanalyzing it to a place where you're kind of like, probably this is a bad idea because of X, Y, and Z. You can always find a reason.
Yeah.
But okay, so one more question. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Max Kaplan. I'm working on a project right now called FOMOprescription.com, and I had a question for you on, you talked about some of your products and companies and how you built the product and then it exponentially grew. Can you talk a little bit more about early stage growth marketing and what you would suggest for the on the B2C side?
That's this guy right here. He does a little growth marketing. You know, I think my stuff is, I suggest the same thing for everything. I have one answer for everything, which is like customer, right? So like, basically why should the customer care? In your case, it's B2C, but like really spending time with that user, that customer base that you're going, trying to go after and see what actually motivates them. I try to like do a lot of, want to do that stuff in person to understand like what really motivates them. And I always think about this spectrum where it's like, you want people to say like, I hate this idea, or that I love this idea, and you want nothing in between. And usually what we spend our time is chasing the stuff in between, which is like, oh, I kind of like it. Oh, if you had this feature, oh, if you changed this button and moved it over here, then I would use it. Oh, maybe. And that's all like no, right? That's the polite way to say like, I don't care enough about this to even say I hate it or that I love it. I don't even care. It's like, and so the thing that you're trying to avoid as an entrepreneur is like indifference. Right, and we spend all our time chasing indifference.
And
right?
This isn't just on product, this is also on sales approach, marketing approach.
This is sales, marketing, product, building a company, right? Like, it's all the same to me. Right. It's like, we spend our time chasing that, and then when we find something, then we try to communicate in our language. Oh, here's why the customer should care. Here's why the user should care. This is why they should download my app. Nobody cares about like, what kind of positioning or why you care about your app. They care about their problem. How's this going to make them feel? Like it's all tying into the emotions of them. And so I would read old books on copywriting.
Yeah.
There's lots of old books that are out of print that you can read in copywriting because those were the true masters. If you look at guys who and gals who were writing copy for magazine ads that were in the back of magazines that were like this big, and they told you, they described some product, and to get this product that you had never seen before, you had to mail a check in and postage to this and then wait, I don't know, weeks, months, and maybe this thing will come back from this little ad that you read here. These were the masters, right? If these people could actually build companies from these little ads that used to be in magazines, these are the masters that you need to be looking at from a copywriting standpoint to understand what are the emotional triggers that you need to be hitting on for people to care about your product. And so look in go to the library and read a lot of old books on copywriting.
My partner Mike actually blogged on this topic talking about a company or portfolio called Dia & Company and how at the first time he ever spoke to him about their customer, he was very caught off guard by how much they talked about she. Uh-huh. She does this, she does that, here's why she does this, here's why. It's just like totally in the head of the customer, not just calling it my customer and our users and our...
And so you have to talk to that. And those all the stuff that we've done in our world in the digital marketing side and conversion rate optimization, blah, 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 all this stuff, that stuff's all old, right? Like if you know, I would talk to guys back in the day who worked at Fingerhut, which was an old catalog company, and digital marketing, this whole thing stems from direct marketing from back then, right? This is not, none of this is new, right? This is just a new
just better vehicle, tools.
Better tools to do the same stuff, right? So
good. Well, just one final note. You're going to be getting a survey tomorrow. We really do take it very seriously. I hope you'll fill it out. It does help us a lot. One of the things we do from that survey is figure out which guests to have in the future, and David's name's come up numerous times. So he's here partially because...
That was our bot.
Yeah, exactly, the bot. Sent it over and over again. He's here because people wanted him here, and we need that input. We also just need feedback to make this the best event it could be. I also didn't thank Microsoft at the beginning. They've donated their space for 14 of the 16 founder dialogues we've done. They're renovating the space, and we won't be doing the next one here. This is our last one, so I just thank them for that. And most of all, David, thank you. This was an absolute pleasure. Many years in the making.
Thank you. Thanks.